So let's begin, and to open today's session, I am very pleased to introduce a remarkable man who headed European and Eurasian issues for the National Security Council, served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State, went on to be the U.S. Representative to NATO, and today is the Executive Director of the McCain Institute for International Leadership. I'm pleased to present Ambassador Kurt Volker.
Well, thank you, Ernie. It is an honor for me to be here. As Ernie mentioned, I have the privilege of serving as the executive director of the McCain Institute. And just a quick word about the McCain Institute before we launch into the program for today. The McCain Institute was founded to honor the legacy of service to our country of the McCain family, Senator McCain and Mrs. Cindy McCain, the McCain family going back generations. And it is trying to capture in an institution many of the things that are characteristic of that legacy of service. One of them is a core commitment to character and values as a guiding principle for anyone to exercise leadership in any walk of life. But another is a commitment to action, that it is not enough to understand a problem, to talk about it, to make recommendations about a problem, but having done that, it is critical to take action. And that is an ethos that we have tried very hard to build into the McCain Institute. And it is truly embodied by Mrs. Cindy McCain's work on combating human trafficking. She is the chair of the McCain Institute's Human Trafficking Advisory Council. A number of our members of that advisory council are here. Charlie Black, I see. Ernie Allen, of course, who is our MC today. I'm sure there are others in the audience. It is terrific to have that kind of leadership, that passion, and that drive that we get from our chair and from our council. And to give you an illustration of some of the things that the McCain Institute has launched, in addition to sponsoring original research to collect data, which is critical in understanding the problem and pushing for action about the problem, we've now taken a wider effort with leadership from Arizona State University as well in seeking to create a methodology for producing a national prevalence report, which would really be quite remarkable if that is something that can be achieved. In the meantime, through Mrs. McCain's leadership of the Governor's Task Force in Arizona, we've seen new legislation introduced, first in Arizona, later in other states in the Mountain West. We've seen improved training for social services and law enforcement. We have seen a real emphasis on identifying victims as victims rather than as prostitutes or other things, and identifying perpetrators as those who are committing very serious crimes, and in the case of minors, child sexual abusers. So getting the terminology and the legal framework right, something we fought very hard to achieve. We are continuing to expand our efforts in this area, and that is why we are so pleased to be able to hold our second annual symposium on human trafficking here today, because it is working together in partnership with all of you, all of the organizations that you represent, and bringing together all of the ideas that you have, that we can continue to develop an action-oriented agenda for what we can do. And our hope is that all of us, first as a McCain Institute, but also all of you, leave here today with a clear idea of what actions we will be taking to continue to fight to eliminate this problem forever. So I want to thank you all for coming. And before we begin the remainder of our program, I'd also like to introduce a video message, which is from another member of our Human Trafficking Advisory Council, Ashton Kutcher.
Hi, I want to say thank you to the McCain Institute for bringing this together. I have some short remarks. I'm off script, which is always dangerous, but I won't take long because I know we have work to do. This job that we do is not fun. The stuff that we work on is the least pleasant thing that I work on in my life, because I know that on the other side of the work that I have to do is someone in pain. I know there's someone that's hurting. I know there's someone that slipped through the cracks. I know there's a system that has not been built to support their needs. And that makes this work not fun. But it's your compassion, it's your care, it's your thoughtfulness, it's your effort, it's your love that is going to change it. that's going to make it better. And now more than ever, we need it. We have people coming into our country from war-torn territories, and we should invite them, and we should care about them. We should vet them and care about them. But those people will slip through the cracks because our system is currently broken. It's broken for the people that live here. And so, of course, it's going to be broken for people that are coming in a mishigosh. Thank you for being you. Thank you for being in the room that I can't be in today. And thank you for the work that you do.
Julie, I think he does just fine off script. The first panel of the day, Ashton talked about the challenge of dealing with those in pain, those for whom there have been inadequate resources. Our first panel of the day, we're going to hear from survivors, people whose courage and tenacity is making a difference and who are changing that situation that Ashton Kutcher talked about. So if I could invite them to join us on the stage. Particularly pleased that we have with us today two members of the first U.S. Advisory Council on Human Trafficking. The council was appointed by President Obama in December 2015, and all 11 of its members are survivors of human trafficking. So with us today, at my far right, your left, is Ronnie Marty, who's a victim of labor trafficking who came to the United States from the Dominican Republic in 2009. Today, Ronnie is an activist in the fight against labor trafficking. We're honored to have him here.
Thank you.
Next to Ronnie is Chandra Wovoruntu. And Chandra is a survivor of human trafficking and domestic violence who came to the United States from Indonesia. She escaped her traffickers and then helped to convict them in a court of law. And today, she is a great champion and leader for this cause. Our third panelist is someone well known to virtually everyone in the room, I'm confident. Tina Front is the founder and executive director of Courtney's House in Washington, D.C., a shelter for child victims of domestic sex trafficking. Tina, herself a survivor, dedicates her life to helping women and children heal from trafficking and exploitation. And finally, I'm pleased to introduce our moderator, someone you also know well, for this important panel. In 2003, Andrea Powell founded Fair Girls, and since then has led efforts to prevent sex trafficking and exploitation in the United States, Bosnia, Serbia, Montenegro, Russia, Uganda. She's a leader domestically and internationally, and she's also a professor in the Elliott School of International Affairs at George Washington University. So let me turn this important first panel over to Andrea Powell.
Thank you, Ernie. Can you all hear me okay? Excellent. I'm Andrea Powell. I'm the co-founding executive director of Fair Girls. We have a quick panel, but I think one of the most exciting panels of the day. I'm going to try to keep the flow going. We're going to start with Tina Front sharing a little bit about her story and quickly go on to Chandra and Ronnie as well, and then we'll loop back to some of the more substantive questions about the council.
Hello, I'm Tina Front, and I'm the founder and executive director of Courtney's House. Courtney's House is a drop-in center that's based here in D.C. We cover D.C., Maryland, Virginia, and just about everywhere for different services and training. As a survivor of domestic sex trafficking, I really wanted to focus on domestic sex trafficking because there wasn't a lot of services. So we focus on street outreach at night from 3 a.m. to 7 a.m. We work with boys and girls who were trafficked. We also work with long-term programs like support groups that are really based off transitioning your mindset out of the life. So when we use words like rescue, just remember that that word is really for us. Because you transition a mind, you rescue a body. Thank you.
My name is Chandra Wovoruntu. I came to the United States because of political turbulence in my country and religious persecution happening. It was 1998, and I lost the job as an international money market treasury manager, and I was a financial analyst, and I lost the job. So I expanded employment to the United States because of I see United States is the dreamland. If you live outside the United States, what you see is the goodness about the United States. Beautiful people in the movie, handsome, no poverty, no homeless. So all excellent, right? And I deal with money market, so I know the power of US dollar. US dollar is the power of global economy. So I knew exactly when they said in the advertisement, 6 month period work in the hotel, I got legitimate paperwork, I got my visa with the promise 5,000 a month. Of course I take it, right? Because I got only 250 a month when I work in Indonesia. The fact I was kidnapped, I didn't go to Chicago, I was kidnapped and I was lured into sex trafficking in New York and up and down the route I-95 in the Prato Hotel and everywhere, and I escaped. I helped law enforcement and finally they raid the place, the Prato, and I reunited with many many girls that were trafficked. And I learned from that, I married with someone that actually there is an intersection in between domestic violence and human trafficking. Because my husband used to ask me to work 7 days a week, and I never see the money, because the money, he took the money and, you know, spent the money for him, and he didn't work. So this is what I learned, and I work in my city, state, and federally. In my city, I advocate to raise the funding for victim services. I use victim because victim potentially receive services. When I say survivor, there is no services available. So in the state, I lobby legislation to pass legislation, and federally I do many different work. Besides, I help to pass legislation, I lobby legislation. So this is what I do. Besides, I promote a survivor leadership, which is mentorship, and then also survivor media training, public speaking, to know the message. As a survivor, we are more than survivor. If you say we are survivor, you just put us in the box. You don't let us grow. So I promote this. What is the message of each survivor to be out there? After we have the message, so we start to do the work. And also for the organization that give us services, I promote client-centered approach, like what I do with my organization, which is we think about the person. Don't give what they don't need. We give what they need. If you don't have, connect them with the resources. So that's what I do, and we can talk again later.
Thank you, Chandra. Ronnie?
Thank you. As they mentioned, my name is Ronnie Mori. I'm from Dominican Republic. And one of the reasons that I'm joining the movement against human trafficking is because back in DR, my country, I received an offer. It was to work in a hotel. So that was the first things that happened with the first promises. It was supposed to be a job in a hotel, in a housekeeping department. So, but I realized when I came here, when I landed in Kansas, that everything changed. When they went to my country to offer us, they said, how they sell the dream is, oh, in the United States, there are a lot of vacancy, a lot of need of people to come to work because there's nobody to do that kind of job. So I was approved for that job and said, okay, it's something that I can do, and it doesn't matter how I start, I can start from the bottom and show my best. That's how I always do in the companies that I work for. So I took the job. When we were in Kansas, our employer, the first things that he said, there's no jobs in hotels. We don't have anything available. And we questioned why. I mean, if it was the thing that you said that you got the most. And he said that the only job that they have available is in a DVD manufacturing company in Huntsville, Alabama. In my case, after bottom of around $4,000 for the program, because that's the thing, what they do too. The recruiter, they charge you a fee. So I have to pay for my visas fee, for the flight tickets, for the interview, for everything I was paying within that package. So I owe money already in my country. There was no way for me to go back when I just had like $50 in my pocket. What I'm going to go back and how I'm going to pay the money that I owe. So I have to accept the job. So we went from Kansas all the way to Huntsville, Alabama. And it just, and it's one of the first things, the promise, the first promise. And the second thing is the advantage that they take of you. I was living in a one-bedroom apartment with two other guys. We were paying $300 each every month. That was being deducted from our paycheck. But we realized that the employer, he was paying only $450 a month. He was making money out of us just in that part. With all the deduction, transportations, all kind of deduction, visa extensions fee, I was making $39, $40 per week. Not enough money to survive and eat properly. Imagine to send money back to my family and pay my debt. So it's when you start your debt band with those guys, because they offer you money. Like, if you don't have like enough money, I can give you more money, and we will just deduct from the paycheck. So thank God my experience, my trafficking experience, didn't last long. I consider myself a blessed survivor of human trafficking because of one of observant landlord where we were living. One time she sent a notice saying that we haven't paid the rent, and said that is impossible because the rent had been deducted from our paycheck. So I went to her and showed her what was going on. She called the my employer, and they have some argument. So she knew something was going on. And that's why it's so important, the awareness. People be aware of what's going on. What are the signals and the signs of human trafficking? So that they can, if you see something, you do something, you say something. So in that case, she was really good because she said, something is wrong. It doesn't look good. So she asked me if I wanted to be interviewed by the a newspaper, a local newspaper in Huntsville. And I said, yes, why not? But I was scared because my employer, he already was talking about, like, you can really leave our company because you're going to be out of the program. So we're just going to ask for deportation for you because you're breaking the law. We got all the information, even though he was not keeping my documents, but he got all information about my family back home. And that's the way he was threatening. And it was not only me, it was another group of people. So when I had the interview with the Huntsville, Alabama, local newspaper, the trafficker heard what happened and he came back to us. That's when we escaped. We ran to New Jersey because we got in contact with another company that was supposed to help us to extend our visa, because that was another fraud. So, and from New Jersey, we stayed like 11 days, and then we ran to Biloxi, Mississippi. But the thing is, during that time, the employer, the trafficker, he was calling and threatening, and, you know, we're going to do this because you guys are, you're breaking the law. By that time, I didn't know anything about human trafficking. That's another thing that is important, that, and I'm glad it's happening now that all the embassies are talking and showing whoever is applying for an H-2B visa intercultural visa, internship, that they are explaining what is human trafficking, that's what about, and what you can find, and how you can respond and look for help. And that's a good thing. It was not there when I applied for my H-2B visa. So it's something that I really applaud that is happening, and this is awareness, this is prevention. That's, to me, the key to really end human trafficking is, of course, you gotta fight what is already in the air, but you gotta bring the awareness and people to know, to do the outreach and people to know what it is. So when I was in Biloxi, Mississippi, I went to a faith-based organization. That's another thing which is important, NGOs and faith-based organization, believe me. All those private companies that are probably giving funding for them to help people in need, homeless, victims of human trafficking, whatever, it's great because the first days, we didn't have any money, and we ate thanks to the food that they gave us. They packed a bag with canned food, rice, and that's what we could eat the first days because we didn't have anything. So thank to them. But also because the knowledge that they have about human trafficking, that person put me in contact with an ICE agent that she was great. And here's another thing. The thing could be done right. That's what I said. I feel blessed myself just for how the things happen with me. But I feel sad at the same time that it's not happening with everybody. There's a lot of victims that they couldn't get the help that I got at the moment. Things could be done right the way they did. The agent, the I agent, she was a person that, I think she was well-trained about trauma-informed and how to approach survival, victims of human trafficking. So, you know, during that time, you don't really trust anyone. But she was a person that really treated us properly and professional. And we were opening and talking, speaking up about what was happening. We were helpful because of her, the way that she was approaching us, the way that she helped us. Because she not only helped us giving some reference, like she was referring to places where we can get help. That's another thing. I mean, if the agents know, okay, this is the case of human trafficking, those guys are victims. Let's just help them. Okay, so you need housing, you can talk to that organization. Or you need this, you can talk to those guys so that they have the information. And it's a good thing. So in my case, as I said, I feel blessed because it's like out of their ordinary. Because just by seeing that it's still victims, they can get the service that they deserve, it's so sad. So that's what I decide to be part of my community, to do the outreach and the awareness and let the people know that this is real, that it could happen to anyone, that we can just close our eyes and say, that's not gonna happen to me because I'm educated. I also have a degree. That happened to me. It was like, I couldn't believe what happened to me until it happened. So it could happen to anyone, and that's what we do in my community, just to let people know what's going on. We wanna also work with the schools and bring some kind of orientation to the children and school. So thank you.
Thank you. So one thing I wanted to point out that I think resonated with what all of you are saying is that many times victims of human trafficking don't know to raise their hand and say, excuse me, I'm a victim of human trafficking. But I have to say in the last few years as a service provider, and perhaps some of you have seen this as well, more and more survivors are coming forward and actually pre-identifying. There is a bit more awareness within different communities, and I think that's incredible progress. Mm-hmm. Very briefly, in under a minute, could each of you speak to some of the challenges, either personally or professionally, that you're facing in advancing this work?
I didn't share some of my story on purpose. I wanted to wait to this piece to explain something. If you noticed from their stories, there was someone that came in and provided services, help. There was some way. And my story is different because at 15, I did go for help, and then I was charged for prostitution and put in juvenile detention. And so that began a whole trend of not trusting. It's different in my community. I always say that I was born in Chicago, but now they call it Chirac, and it was Little Beirut, where I grew up. And I say that because the movies that Chandra is talking about and the world that she looked for was also a dream and a fantasy, and I live in the United States. It was a dream because I never knew of any of these things that existed. Inside my neighborhood, I was never to trust the government ever, and never ever call the police or fire department because they have to report to the police, and we policed our own neighborhood. I'm sure you watch TV, so this is the trend that has not changed in Chicago. And so with that being said, I would never call a poster in a million years with a government number ever. I wouldn't go on a website ever because I would think it's being traced. So that's what we're talking about. When we talk about that this affects African Americans, we don't actually think we have a culture because you can't possibly think that if we're not addressing the real issues or talking to survivors and understanding what they went through. So it's a little bit different. This population is still being arrested and charged as juveniles. So I have to work on policy. I have to work because the same things that happened to me is still going on and nothing has changed. And we say it has. It has changed on awareness, and there are a lot of things you do have to change. And so with that being said, policy. Making sure that the records are vacated, like I had to get mine expunged, and prove the trafficking piece was in it. You know, the funny thing when I had to do this, I've been doing this for a long time, and we got one of our partners, Samara Legal, to help pull off kind of my last piece of charges.
And although I do this work and help so much in policy, I had no idea there was a whole state that this law has not passed yet. So I didn't know how to maneuver it. I didn't know. And I was literally told that I need a code, but they wouldn't tell me what the damn code was. Right? I'm like, what is the law? What is it? They're like, if you can quote it. I'm like, really? Right. So it could be just that frustrating that there's a piece and you need someone. So with trafficking, you need different pieces. You can't provide services if the laws don't match right. You have to advocate for that. You have to advocate in the courtroom. You have to do intakes because this is a population who's criminalized. And because we're criminalized, it doesn't mean we're all running to the police with all this information. And so just remembering who your population is and how to deliver that and how to embed it in a real culture. We say that word culture competent. But are we really understanding what that means with each population that we serve?
Thank you, Tina.
Me? Yes. Thank you. So lesson learned from my experience that I didn't get enough services. So I was homeless, I didn't get the job, and then I have to stand by my own and look for the resources. So learn from my experience, I decided to do something the organization, service provider, don't do. What is that? Survivor empowerment, which is giving them a skill and provide them to get the job. So that is my passion. Because why I didn't get that? Nobody empowered me. I empowered myself to be able to stand. Because I always say, I challenge everybody to be a champion. I challenge everybody to be a champion to find the gap, to find what is missing from the movement, from the services. Take advantage of that. So the challenge that I face in the field is the fourth P. So I will talk about three paradigms safe, which is prevention, protection, and prosecution. We forget the fourth P that introduced in 2009 by Hillary Clinton, which is partnership. In the field, often I see partnership. Everybody fighting for the funding, everybody fighting for the social media, everybody said, this is me. No, please leave your ego. Leave your own personal purpose. Let's come together for the victim, for the survivor. Because what our concentration is in human trafficking. Besides prevention, what happened with people that affected? We give them services, the best that we could, so they can integrate to the community and live independently. Thank you.
Thank you. Ronnie, briefly?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. With the community work that I'm doing, the challenges that I have been facing, it's still in shock when you go out there and you speak to people and you just mention the word human trafficking. Still people nowadays thinking it's just sex trafficking. That's what I've always tried to change and bring, you know, I'm a survival level trafficking. If I would have been in sex trafficking, doesn't matter even to me, but I mean, it's just that people understand that word won't eat you, won't kill you. And then they're afraid their kids to hear that word because they won't be able to respond to what is human trafficking because it's including sex trafficking. So that's the challenge I've been finding. But that's what we always concentrate in those awareness to let people know that this is not the same and it's a problem that is happening in the United States. It's not in a remote part of the world that is only happening, you know? That's it.
Thank you. So we have about 10 minutes left before we start the Q&A. Ronnie, I'm going to loop back to you. Sorry to have you go twice, but can you explain what is the U.S. Advisory Council? What is it comprised of? Any of the inspiration and what propelled you to join? 2 minutes.
It was never my intention to join. I was contacted and went through a different interview. But the Advisory Council is composed of by 11 committed members, which is our experience and have the expertise. So we get together and we give recommendations to the Federal Agency on anti-trafficking policy. After we get all together, we also partner with the NGOs, with the we involve survivors' voices, and we write a report and we submit it. So, but with that, we just want to contribute to end human trafficking, and that's what we're trying to do.
Excellent. Do either of you want to add any more to that?
That's fine.
That's good. Okay, yeah. Thanks, Ronnie. So, Chandra, tell us a little bit more about the U.S. Advisory Council's report. Globally, what's the report? What are some of the challenges you all faced? I think this is fascinating for the audience.
Yes. So this is our first report. If you never seen this, I have few in my bag if you like to have it. So the report made a lot of challenges that we got. One is the time because of geographically 11 members reside in many different states, and so hard for us to come together. And besides the limitation of our time, but finally we published our first report from 5 different committees, and the goal is to end human trafficking. Every recommendation is important. Why it's important? Because every committee work on the specific issue, and we want our recommendation will be implemented. And so far, we have a good feedback from government agencies, and we look forward to work together for the future. The challenges I already mentioned, but for the future challenge is also how we make it happen. I hope the government agencies open up their time, their energy to work with us and make it happen to end human trafficking.
So you mentioned committees, not to light on that word too much, but can you share a little bit more about what types of committees there are?
Yes, we have rule of law, which is a work specifically with DOJ. Actually, Tina is the leader of the committee, and then grant making to make sure the grant, you know, how they will give the grant, how to monitor, and so on. I cannot talk details because the time is like limited now. And public awareness is talk about how, you know, we raise awareness in our community to educate people so they will be aware and they will not be trafficked like us. Labor law, that we work specifically, I and Ronnie work specifically with Labor Department and also another agencies to provide help and support to a survivor of human trafficking to be able to live independently, and also victim services to make sure we have enough funding and the program is survivor input and survivor trauma informed to make sure that our voice is heard by them. Yes.
Thank you. Now, Tina, I know that the council has several goals. Mm-hmm. What, in your opinion, as an advocate, are one of or a few of the most important goals that you see in your work?
Well, you know, I think it's really important, number one, that everybody on there is a survivor. And each survivor also has a different demographic of how they were trafficked. So for us, all of it's important on getting messaging out. The number one message is survivors should be partnered with organizations and people and advocates. If you're starting an organization, you should probably come to a survivor to see what they can do to help. The policy piece, being the root of law with Harold DeSosa and I, here's the thing about that. All of you probably had a training before, and it's probably different each time for someone else does something different. So it's inconsistent without the federal government as well. So the Justice Department, FBI, everyone has a different training. So there is no consistency on the training. So therefore, one of our recommendations was to actually put a manual together. And it will be together for Homeland Security, for FBI, Department of Defense, but it was all pieces of survivors of labor trafficking, domestic servitude that created it. Therefore, it's consistent. It's consistent with the knowledge and help, and breaks down way more information than what people have. Because what I have found is that lots of people had a human trafficking training. But when I train them, they're like, oh my God, this is nothing like I had. It's more information. So we want to make sure that all the public, the general public, all the agencies have the same consistent information, and that you all have the success that we do in helping survivors.
Thank you. Did either of you want to add your own thoughts on challenges?
No, it's, as Tina was saying, I think it's the need and the lack of uniform training, like for everyone, to know how to deal with victims. Because a lot of things happens when one state is doing something, so you go to another state, and they're not doing that way. I never get that type of information, or I never get the trauma-informed approach. You see that there's inconsistency on the trainings and people's knowledge, and that's one of the things that I believe they should unify and say and give one training for everybody to be on the same page.
Yeah, I want to add a little bit. I want to just, this is an encouragement, how the 3P will be applicable for the movement. I want to talk about protection, how we continue the protection to a survivor of human trafficking by treating them with respect, dignity, and humanity. Because right now, still re-exploitation happening to a survivor community, where they use for the media, for the marketing piece, for the PSA, for the video or for documentary film or film. So this is what we want to do as a survivor leader, advocate, and people that been in this movement. We learn that we need to continue to protect survivors by educate them with the survivor media training and also treat them properly. Don't take their life again and again. Don't take advantage of their time again and again. Please, thank you.
So I have one more question before we open it up to Q&A. Tina, you and I work together in the field here in the District of Columbia with colleagues, like you mentioned, Amara. So we have a day in and day out flow around clients and calling each other on cases. But one thing I've always really admired is your strength in speaking to how organizations should really integrate survivor leadership in a fluid and consistent way. Can you speak to some of your methodology and vision behind that before we open to Q&A?
So we have a requirement for positions at Courtney's House for a survivor service coordinator, and we encourage survivors, but you have to be out of your situation and receive counseling for at least 5 years. And let me tell you why. Because sometimes we really want survivors to speak up. So we say, or we put thoughts in their heads, and we tell them that they're ready. And so what actually happens is this: I feel that I owe you something because you helped me. So I'm going to. So when you put words like rescue and things, a rescue means I owe you for something. The thing is this: I get blamed when I leave it, though, because I wasn't ready and because it takes a mind to transition. And because I helped you, I'll say yes. I'll say, yes, okay, I want to do it, okay, I'll speak, and I'll knowingly go back into the life because I wasn't ready for it, and then I'm not going to call you the second time. And so as service providers, we should probably know, even if someone's an adult, if they are really and truly ready, because don't do that. We don't want to put them in a spotlight when they're not. We have this spotlight that's following them, now that's even more reason. And so thinking about it from that aspect, very quickly, of understanding that it's really not about you. It's about you helping them to see what they need. Some people just want to be an accountant, right? They can be an accountant. That doesn't mean that they have to come and share their story. So just remembering that.
Thank you, Tina. So we are going to open up to 10 minutes of Q&A. Thank you. So I'll be looking for the first question. Yes, in the very back. If you don't mind introducing yourself very quickly and then asking your question.
Yes, I'm short. Oh, thank you. Thank you all for being here. You're all a national treasure. In the healthcare aspect, do you know if there's any efforts afoot that have changed over the past few years that awareness has been increased, that doctors and nurses are getting any training in this to recognize in the emergency room? I happen to be a nurse by profession. And I'm very interested in the human trafficking, the healthcare aspect of human trafficking all over the world because, first of all, it's the most egregious crime I've ever heard of. And we will never get rid of this kind of scourge if, when victims come to the hospital and we don't recognize them. Mm-hmm. I've polled my fellow nurses and doctors, and they don't even know if they've seen a victim of human trafficking. And I'm sure these victims come to the emergency room and we don't know.
Thank you, ma'am. Tina, do you want to take that?
Yeah. So I'm going to give a shout out to Health and Human Services. If you go on their website, there's a program called SOAR, S-O-A-R. Many of us, including myself, are authors who helped develop that. So it was actually developed by a lot of survivors as well. And it's particularly for the healthcare community as well. And so then in this area, there's been actually a lot of training, and actually around the country, there are a lot of hospitals now that actually have programs inside of them as well for identifying, and we do too. So I'm sure after the panel, you can talk to some people and they can point you to an area in your state or city that probably does have a protocol. You're welcome.
Next question.
I'm still on the healthcare kick because I am also a nurse. So I have a question for the survivors. Did you ever have a point in time that you came in contact with a healthcare professional, and during that point in time, what could have been offered to you or what was offered to you that was helpful or worked?
Not in my case. I never went to the healthcare. I did after I escaped with all the services that were provided to me. That was part of the services, but I never like had the need to go there. No.
Yeah, similar like me, I never deal with the medical practitioner or emergency while I was in the situation. But after that, it's hard to find the perfect medical practitioner and also mental health that truly understand how to work with the survivor. That's why we need to do more training, especially for psychiatric and therapists, on how to work with a survivor. Not only like my case, especially domestic, sometimes they're not ready, they come and go, but they deal with the mental health. So I think it's very important to create a survivor-informed, a training for them, and also how to have a self-care for those people that work with the survivor. Because I have one experience, my psychiatric told me, Miss Wawarundu, are you sure that you are kidnapped? Are you sure that you are sold? I was so angry. And I never deal with that psychiatric anymore. One day when I was pregnant, I got a flashback and I went to mental health again. And what they do is, I think that's your own fault. Why you take your job? So this is kind of the language that not supposed to be in the trafficking field.
Even though, let me just add this, even though I didn't experience that, but I've been working with survivors who did, and the things that question came up a few times, and something that they would like to see differently that work for them is when they get into the ER room, if they come with someone who is translating to them, or it's a person who is all the time sticking to them, like you can notice something it's going on, why you don't allow the person to be alone. Or if they could have, they could have someone to tell what happened by being alone with the nurse, that could be great, but that person was never alone with the nurse. And another thing the nurse never asked any question about, you know, how that happened, you know, because they were never trained. But what the survivor would like to found in their way is that they be aware, like, that I can speak to you with my eyes, I need help, you know, like, if we can be alone, take me to another room or whatever. Something like that they wanted to have that it was not happening before. But as Tina mentioned, the sword training, it's all about that, and it's great.
I just wanted to quickly say my help was actually a rape crisis hotline, who I partner with, DC Rape Crisis Center. And it wasn't anything to do with sex trafficking. It was just a piece for the sexual assault, which is why we partner with Prince George's County Sexual Assault and Domestic Violence and DC Rape Crisis Center, and they know how to screen now. And I say that because they're housed at the hospital, but people don't ask the right questions. So they have incorporated our screening tools in it, because actually a lot of our survivors come through sexual assault. If you knew and understood the background of that you were actually raped in and knew the right questions, like that's very common, but people weren't knowing how to identify that. So yes, on that piece, mental health. You know, similar to Chandra's story is also mine. First, my issue was mental health. And so when I tried to get help, a psychiatrist actually told me, when I just gave her like a brief summary of my life, you don't know, I ain't want to traumatize her too much. Right. Listen to that statement. Because what she said to me was, oh my God, you only try to commit suicide once? I would have thought you would have tried more than that. So that was the end for me. I was out at that. But then remember that, like, the statements and things people say make you close down for more. And 98%, including myself, of all of our survivors had severe some type of mental health issues beforehand. So if we know in America right now, people aren't getting the correct mental health right now. Take trafficking out of it and then I'll add it back in. So then now even more do not have this specialized counseling or even know how to identify. So we should never be shocked that our numbers are increasing. What we should be happy about is that at least we're identifying more so they can finally get the right services.
Thank you. We have time for two more quick questions. Maurice?
There's the HEAL Network, H-E-A-L. You just go online. It's run by Hannah Stokolosa, who's an ER doc out of Brigham and Women's Hospital. And she's put together just an amazing resource that you can get a lot of information about how to work with trafficking victims. There's also the Caring for Trafficking Victims Handbook that was put out by Kathy Zimmerman, which is another excellent piece of work. And I just wanted to bring that to the group as resources to help with trafficking victims.
Thank you. Another question? The one over here and then the gentleman over there.
Hi. I focus more on the prevention aspect with adolescents, and my question is for the panelists. I find that there's a disconnect and a barrier when it comes to talking about human trafficking in our school system. It's not received very well, and it becomes somewhat disheartening. So I just wanted to know if you guys had any type of suggestions or what could be done from a policy aspect or any type of aspect where the school system, the education system, is more open to us talking about this in our health and PE courses. And they put a lot of different barriers and red tape before you can even go forward to talk about it. But it happens a lot within our school systems and the culture and just different things. And so I just want to know, is there any way that we can get the education system to be more open to talking about this with students?
Interesting. I like the question. So this is what happened. I and a group of a network of survivors, we went to the Department of Education to advocate about how human trafficking piece will be in the curriculum or in the school system. But the fact, they are not ready yet. And we keep talking and request if it will be available for the student, whether extra curriculum or, you know, even 1 hour is very important. But the good thing is organization do education and also awareness campaigns in the school system. ECPAT will launch, an educational piece, like book, like comic book. It's similar what I do, but not in the United States. I did in Indonesia. So I met about 10,000 students in the school system using the comic book. And it is really awesome because it's work easily for the student. So from age 9 to 16, they see the book. Not too much conversation, but from the picture, we educate them how the sex trafficking, how labor trafficking, the debt bondage, and also how important the school and the family. Yeah, I hope we'll be more and more in the school system, even we try to get the educational piece of human trafficking in the police academy too. So I believe some of police academy already have. Thank you.
I won't ask. Well, I'll say it real quick, because in this area, and I'm sure Fair Girls also goes into schools as well. You do go into the schools under the health education. But also, I do a back door always. And the back door is my referrals come from middle school and come from schools. So because they're referring to me and I trained them, then they advocate for me to come in. And so I don't actually have that kind of issue, because by the time they're noticing, right, because I keep all my numbers, so if you're noticing that your counselors are referring to me 1 to 3, 1 to 5 times in Montgomery County and Virginia, then you might have somewhat of an issue. So we're able to bring it a different way. But we work with the care teams there. So in different schools, there are case managers or mental health programs inside the schools, and that's who Courtney's House works with.
And Tina's absolutely correct. We definitely see that you have to have a multifaceted approach in going into schools and really think about each individual culture, because what works in one community, whether it's Prince George's County or D.C., it might actually be quite different from community to community. Last question over here.
Sure. Thank you all, and thank you for your leadership and sharing your stories. This question comes at a slightly different angle, but Ronnie, I was struck by your comment about how in your experience, part of the reason you were able to get out of the situation you're in was due to someone looking at the financial situation with regard to the forced labor trafficking going on in your situation. I work for a group that focuses on illicit finance and its role in criminal and corrupt behavior across the board, including trafficking. And we have a mantra, which is follow the money if you really want to understand how the system works and to find intervention points further upstream. So my question wasn't, this is things like shell companies, money laundering, including activities that actually enlist the people being trafficked into that behavior. So I'm curious if you all have any quick thoughts on A, what this community can do to look at that aspect of the problem associated with trafficking, and also to the earlier point, how we can learn from people who've been in the experience how the money part of the equation works from the inside out, because if we're not learning from how survivors experience that, we're missing a piece of the puzzle.
Yeah, thank you. One of the things that I believe that really help is that we can do this by ourselves. We all need to be involved. And those faith organizations and the NGOs and the service provider, I mean, they are like the main point for the victims to go and approach them. So they are the one that have the ability to reach out as survivors. But the thing is, community need to be involved in that. Community need to know what's going on with the human trafficking in order to help also those NGOs or entities that are advocating for human trafficking. So, yeah.
So to add your question about labor trafficking, I think it's very important that we can introduce or talk about the slavery footprint, that to find how many people that you slave every day, to just give a few to the community that from the food that you eat, from the clothes that you wear, from the technology, your iPhone that you use, it's all about labor trafficking, about forced labor, about cheap labor, about child labor. It's very important to talk about that. Thank you.
I just wanted to quickly say, when we think about US citizen being trafficked, I hear stories like this when people call me. They'll say that I keep seeing this girl, or I see these girls on the street. I see this girl all the time at the gas station, the same hotel keeps getting hit over and over. And then people say, in the US, is there any kind of combined trafficking? And I go, really, is that what we're doing? So we can't understand why the same Super 8 is in this paper 8 times. So obviously they're not crooked. And so we take it out and we go, oh, I don't know, why on earth? Or why is this person at the gas station? Because the people that own the gas station couldn't possibly be taking a cut and working directly with the traffickers. And this is why survivors are needed, because even police access, right? And so we have to, because you may not be aware of this. So the U.S., what actually happens is, for that 13-year-old child, we built our whole entire case off of a 13-year-old child, which means that we did not build, and we didn't look into the gas stations, and we didn't look into all the drug traffic, what the percentage of money that this person is getting, because we didn't look into the 8 times this one hotel has been in the newspaper over and over again, and they're as shocked as you are. And no one has idea we didn't do that. Instead, we asked the survivor to drive us around in the back seat of the car and point out everywhere that they were forced in sex traffic and raped in. Instead, we do it that way. And so I think that's why it's important to have survivors train on this. And this is actually part of the training I was saying. More investigative pieces so they can understand and build the connection, because for US citizens, we are getting the one pimp And then we're going, oh my God, why are they still trafficking? We've got the one guy. Well, we're not looking at it as an organized crime, because you could remove the one person out, that's fine. It's just that the whole network is going to continue to thrive.
Thank you, Tina. Thank you, Shonda and Ronnie. I think we're at close. Thank you,
Andrea. Yeah, Cindy.
I just wanted to thank all of you. I'm Cindy McCain, for your voices on this issue.
Thank you for being brave enough, for being thoughtful enough and caring, and most importantly, being tenacious enough to be a part of this. Thank you for being here today.
Andrea and Tina, Ronnie and Chandra, thank you for bringing that message. Clearly, it sent a message about the importance of survivor leadership, and a couple of takeaways for me. Tina told us you can't provide services if the laws don't match. So this is not a problem that can be solved in isolation. Chandra told us we need to find the gaps and come together for the victims. So the need for a comprehensive approach. And Ronnie told us that this is about more than sex and that all aspects need to be involved. So I think that sets the stage for the conversations that will follow. So now I am pleased to introduce our next presenter, Mary Mazzio, who is an award-winning documentary filmmaker, attorney, and Olympian, who was a rower for the United States in the 1992 Olympics in Barcelona, Spain. Her films have been seen by audiences nationwide and worldwide, and let me just briefly mention two. Her 1999 film, A Hero for Daisy, about Title IX pioneer Chris Ernst, won a Gracie Award, a Women's Foundation Journalism Award, and was aired nationwide on ESPN, among others. Her 2014 film, Underwater Dreams, told the story of how the sons of undocumented Mexican immigrants built an underwater robot from Home Depot parts and defeated a team of engineers from MIT. The film was screened at the White House and raised more than $100 million for the Let Everyone Dream Coalition. But Mary's here today to talk about her newest project, I Am Jane Doe, a powerful documentary for which she interviewed trafficking survivors, focuses on Backpage, and the remarkable fact that businesses like this are still protected by Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act. So I'm very pleased to present Mary Mazzio.
How's everybody doing? I can't tell, Cindy, where are you? Thank you so much for having me. Megan, Charlotte, it's actually an honor for me to be with you. You guys have been doing the heavy lifting. You've been in the trenches. I'm fairly new to this issue. My team is new to this issue. And we came in about a year and a half ago. And the reason we came in to join you as allies is because I happened to read an article in the Boston Globe. And it was about Jane Doe number one, Jane Doe number two, and Jane Doe number three from Boston, who had filed suit against Backpage.com, which many of you know was the former and iconic Village Voice. And I remember thinking to myself, child sex trafficking, like, this is happening here in the United States. This is, I had, like so many Americans, believed that it was really constrained to developing countries and that it would happen maybe to a kid here, a kid there. And I read the article and I was blown away by the scope and the numbers and really what was a human rights crisis. And the second thing that hit me was the Village Voice. This was the Village Voice. These were, you know, people who spoke truth to power, going after corruption, going after scandal. How did it happen that the Village Voice evolved into the number one commercial destination for commercial sex, including human trafficking? And then the third thing that really struck me was that Jane Doe number one, Jane Doe number two, and Jane Doe number three had lost their case at the federal in front of a federal district judge. And I remember thinking, how can it possibly be legal to host advertisements for children? What's up with that? So we jumped in to create a film. And I'll tell you, at first, we were going to really focus on what were kind of thorny legal issues. We were going to focus on the lawyers involved. And the lawyers involved were such characters. You had this one lawyer in Seattle that was, he's like a one-man wrecking crew. He's a former criminal defense lawyer. He works out of a strip mall. And he represented five Jane Does in Seattle. And I met him, and he's bigger than life. And of course, in Boston, Ropes and Gray, which is one of the oldest white shoe law firms, had jumped in, you know, very stately. And so I began to meet these lawyers across the country. And I said, you know, is it possible for me to meet your clients? May I meet the Jane Does? And I met every Jane Doe that was involved in all of these pieces of litigation, and that changed everything. And this became their story. This became their voice. And their voice is what, it's interesting. We're now in the process of launching the film. And a journalist said to me, this is kind of like a modern day Erin Brockovich. And I said, that's exactly what it is. We have some survivors that have sacrificed so much to join the lawsuit, to be in the film, and they're channeling their grief and their trauma into forward momentum. And I remember saying to one of these young women, she was 13 years old at the time that she was trafficked. I said to her, why did you join this lawsuit? At some point in time, you will have to reveal your identity. And she looked at me and she said, well, because I don't want it to happen to my little sister. And to a T, every last Jane Doe child that I spoke with said exactly the same thing. One of them looked me in the eye and said, do you have a daughter? And I said, I have a daughter. And she said, I am doing this for your daughter. Would she do it for me? And I said, it's on. I mean, the commitment that these young women displayed was mind-boggling. So that brings us to the film. And I think the children in the film, as Ernie alluded to, they keep running into and losing their cases by virtue of Section 230. I know many of you in the audience are well acquainted with Section 230, but it really is a statute that was enacted when the internet was just beginning that basically says, if you're a website, you have absolutely no responsibility for third-party content. None. And it kind of made sense back in the day when the internet was beginning. And in fact, sort of ironically, Section 230 was enacted in response to a lawsuit filed by Jordan Belfort. If you're not sure who that name is, it's the Wolf of Wall Street that was portrayed by Leonardo DiCaprio. Well, you probably remember he's like a total crook, right? So in the early days, 1996, Prodigy is a bulletin board, and they have a money site. Somebody goes on and says, boy, Stratton Oakmont and Jordan Belfort, those guys are manipulating Steve Madden's shoe stock. Those guys are crooks. They're felons. Belfort's firm, they get really pissed off. They say, we're going to sue. They sued Prodigy, and they said, you should have caught this post. You're trying to filter content. You are responsible for what's on your site. Prodigy said, well, we have so much content. How can we possibly do that? Well, in fact, the judge ruled, this is defamation. You are like a newspaper, like the New York Times. You are responsible. And so Jordan Belfort walked away with a hefty settlement from Prodigy. And of course, the irony is, he was a crook. And he later was indicted. Nonetheless, Congress enacted Section 230 really as a prophylactic to frivolous lawsuits. Fast forward 20 years, and there have been, by the way, 300 cases now on Section 230. Most of them are in the context of defamation. So Jane Doe, MA, in St. Louis in 2010, her mother rescued her single-handedly. The reason she and her mother filed suit against Backpage was because her mother, after rescuing her, saw her daughter's 13 years old, photos on Backpage, called up Backpage, please take the pictures of my 13-year-old daughter off. She's a minor. Take those pictures off. Didn't take them off. Called again. Called again. Called again. Take those effing pictures off your site. She's a minor. Backpage refused to do it, said you need, we need a warrant from a police officer. Okay. MA's mother was so incensed that she said, these people are culpable in some measure. I'm going to go file suit. So this was one of the first times Section 230 had been applied to alleged criminal activity, which was this. Is Backpage responsible in some part for the damages that these children have suffered? Judge said, sorry, you lose. A group in Seattle of Jane Doe's, a group of Jane Doe's in Boston. In Boston, interestingly enough, the issue gets even more egregious. Just last month, so they lose in front of a federal district court. Ropes and Gray gears up, and there is a hearing before judge, a three-judge panel, including Justice Souter from the United States Supreme Court. I'm in the hearing. And Justice Souter says, so Mr. Montgomery, who's representing Jane Doe, now how is this different than what the Washington Post might do to stimulate a Washington Days car sale? Like, why is this different to create a thriving sex trade? I remember thinking, like, I have gone down the rabbit hole. Like, did he just say that? Is he either being provocative, woefully ignorant? Like, it blew me away. And I remember coming out of the hearing, and there were all kinds of questions, and the ropes team was like, you know, we're pretty hopeful. We think that the court understood that you cannot engage in criminal activity and be shielded, right? Well, as it so happens, the decision came down about a month ago, and actually 2 months ago, and basically the court found Section 230 precluded any responsibility, and the court went on to say, and they've expanded the barrier and protection of Section 230 so far. They basically said if Backpage had participated in, profited from, and encouraged child sex trafficking, sorry, our hands are tied. Go to Congress. That's where our project comes in. So, we are going to show a trailer, but I think fundamentally the children are asking this question. To what extent are online portals responsible for online harm? And you're seeing this issue pop up now, Facebook and fake news. It's the exact same issue. Facebook is sort of internally imploding. Like, what do we do? What's our responsibility? You know, we are now, and Cindy, you were quoted, I think, just the other day in an interview with Soledad O'Brien, technology has far outpaced our regulatory system. And if the New York Times and Washington Post are responsible for third-party content, why is it that new media, which is so profitable and so mature, and by the way, has really sophisticated algorithms. I mean, if you are out there, so I don't know if you have noticed, but I went on to buy a pair of rain boots, right? And so everywhere I go online, I see these same rain boots popping up. And I'm like, where's my internet freedom, right? I have no internet freedom. They know where I am, and they track me with these effing rain boots everywhere I go. It's like, I now have three pair, three different colors. And if you can track me in my rain boots, the fact that you say you don't have a responsibility to track people who are selling children with photos of children, now's the time to ask that question. So we have three real goals with our project. Number one is to create awareness. And I don't have to say that to this crowd. You have been in this fight. But I can't tell you the number of journalists. And by the way, we're getting reviewed at, like, Cosmo's coming out with an article, Glamour, Vogue, Esquire just gave us an incredible review of the film. I can't tell you the number of journalists that have called me and said, I had not a clue this was happening in this country. So number one is awareness. Number two is to expose these legal issues. And these legal issues are really thorny because who is showing up in court to support Backpage? The Electronic Frontier Foundation, the Center for Democracy and Technology. These are two high-powered special interest groups funded primarily by tech companies. This becomes a bit of a challenge, right? Because the tech companies are actively supporting Backpage, actively not supporting the children. And that support, combined with the rulings of these federal judges, who I think really have not a clue what's happening, is really why we're doing this project. So with that, we open February 10 in theaters, coming to you in D.C. We would love for you to tell everybody you know, hashtag I Am Jane Doe, and we're going to give you a flavor. We're going to run the trailer. And one other thing, American Federation of Teachers, my other friends out here, we're working with the guys that won the Academy Award last year for Best Animated Short, narrated by Jessica Chastain, written by the guy that did Toy Story, and we wrote an 8-minute animated short with 10 survivors between the ages of 13 and 21. It's a riff on Little Red Riding Hood. That is going to be out in a month and a half. We're going to blast that. It's free. If it can be a tool in your toolbox around prevention, we would be so thrilled. So thank you for having me. We're just going to roll the trailer. Please, February 10, everybody you know, hashtag I Am Jane Doe. Thank you, Cindy.
This is the United States. There's no possible way this is true.
I sent her out with one of her friends, and she didn't come back.
Next thing you know, boom.
She brought her into a life of hell.
It was like shopping on Amazon.
You're just a product.
Well, the most popular internet site for escorts is called Backpage.com, where authorities say underage girls are sold for sex.
Backpage is the Walmart of human trafficking.
It's an incredibly profitable business.
We will never be the family we were before she was sold on that website.
We need someone to give us a fighting chance.
What if it was your daughter? How would you feel then?
It's a very important case.
Are these people wholesaling children in Washington State or not?
I'd like to meet the member of the judiciary or a member of Congress that thinks that the status quo is satisfactory.
I'd like to call the CEO of Backpage, Carl Ferrer.
I've never seen anything like that.
What are they hiding?
This hearing is adjourned.
There is a question as to what kind of society we're going to be, whether we're going to tolerate sexual trafficking in children. That is an affront to everything that we believe.
I want my daughter to hold her head high and know that none of this was her fault.
I am Jane Doe.
I am Jane Doe.
It's time for us all to stand up and be strong.
I am Jane Doe.
Thank you, Mary. Powerful message. And I hope everyone will see it and use it. We're going to take a 15-minute coffee break now, and then we'll come back and go to the breakout session. So come back promptly at 10:35.